started.
Yeah, I remember.
I want to welcome you all to come, or to be here for our Cardinal conversation today. This is our 12th Cardinal conversation, the fourth one this year. And so pleased to have somebody from the art department. This is our first speaker from the art department. So,
Yay!
We got some people from communications in the fine arts, but anyway. So our title today is The Invested Observer, and you know Xenia
Fedorchenko.
Thank you. And Steve and Zani are our speakers today.
We're also pleased to have an yes. professor.
Yeah. Ken and I were English majors, and so English is near and dear to us. The art room
must
is from the Dishman. I know what I was going to say. So today we are diverging from a rule that I made at the outset that we would have no visuals. But it is not a PowerPoint, so we have not compromised that far. But we do have visuals today, and so this is our first time with this setup. So I appreciate everybody. I know it's a little crowded in here, so thank you for making it work, the room that we have. And we're just delighted to have you here. So I believe the format today, what happens is each speaker will talk for, say, 25 minutes or so, and then we'll have Q&A at the end. So you kind of be thinking about what you'd like to ask. And I believe Stephen is going to speak first, kind of introduce the topic and give us some initial information, and then Xenia will take over. Okay?
All right. Thank you. Will there be applauding at the end? I'm glad we got that done. When Xenia and I sat down to try to figure out what we were going to do here, we kicked around a lot of different ideas because we worked together for 4 or 5 years now, and it's been a very fruitful collaboration. So how to project that to you and sort of give you an idea of it and directions it could go was difficult. And what we have done is taught two classes together at various times, and had some students bring their work to the National Honors Council with Dr. Dodson's help through honors. But it's been a fruitful collaboration in a lot of ways. So we thought, well, we would like to talk about a little bit about that, but also, you know, what's that collaboration about in general in terms of asking these kinds of questions, like what is art, and or what is beauty, truth, what are these things that art approaches, and one way to put this is that. I suppose, interestingly enough for me, what is art and what is it we're talking about when we talk about art? Those are two different questions. And that in the classroom, that's sort of part of the complexity of it, is trying to think about what art is without pigeonholing art in certain ways. And maybe the whole history of art is part of that question. So I think that's part of what we wanted to open up today was that. And so to do that, I think my task, we decided, would be, you know, I'll march you through some of the boring parts of it, which is some of it is this kind of question of what's the history of the philosophy of art criticism and of thinking about art, and then we can sort of see how there are ways art fits into that. And so that's how I wanted to begin, is I'll just throw a few things at you. It ultimately, you'd see it's not really about us doing that, though. Like, this is what art's supposed to be, and then you produce it. I think maybe you could say art's something that escapes that. At least that's what's been useful about us working together, is escaping from certain kinds of things rather than sort of being pinned into them. On that note, the real history of art in terms of art criticism begins more or less with Plato. Just in terms of people writing things down. And And there's a very traditional way of reading Plato in this, which is very often people just look to Plato's Republic, where the gesture is that art is understood as representative. So for Plato, the allegory of the cave, which is sort of generally assume everyone's had beaten into them at some point in their education. As a philosophy major, I had Plato's allegory given to me 5 times in different classes. I thought, that's enough. But the idea is that there are these shadows on the cave wall, and if one is going to understand truth and reality, you would escape the cave. So for Plato, at least in the context of the Republic, art is not really that great of a thing, right? It's perceived as Plato being somewhat against art. Because why? Well, because art is just representation. If even real tables are already a kind of step away from the good, because tables will decay, they are not permanent, as opposed to the idea of the table, which is abstract and true and what you should really be studying. Then a picture of a table is a step removed from that, and then so art is a movement away from anything you would want to think. That's a traditional understanding of Plato. Plato's actually much more slippery than that. There are all these other places in Ion and the Symposium where he doesn't talk that way. But that's it's a very standard understanding of art. Representation by Mises. So what happens historically is then people who follow him, Aristotle with his Poetics, but then a bunch of Neoplatonists too, champion art in one form or another. They say one of the ways that argument goes is, okay, it's representational, but that can actually be a movement towards the good, let's say. And so for Aristotle, if someone in a drama could be representative of a characteristic that was universal and true, then that would lead us to think about those things. And it could lead us to happiness as well. It could be cathartic, it could purge negative emotions from us. So this is one way that art then becomes sort of salvaged as an idea. That's Aristotle, but it's several other people as well. And maybe you could even say Plato, frankly. That becomes this kind of basic framework for a lot of ways people think about art for a long time, even today. And I would just jump forward to the 16th century. Sir Philip Sidney, this defending poetry, says that the goal of poetry, the goal of creative work, would be to teach and delight. And so those become this kind of standard way people used to think about how art and poetry and creativity was, what it was supposed to be doing and how you would judge it. What is my painting doing? Well, is it teaching a particular kind of lesson? And how well does it do that? And is it making people happy when it does it? That's a very traditional understanding that a lot of people still have about art. Halfway me too, right? I don't want to see things that don't make me happy. What does happen then after that, though, is pure craziness. The next person I would say becomes this major figure that we end up talking about and working with a lot is Immanuel Kant. Kant is like the elephant in the room. We have a love-hate relationship with him. It's this romantic, pre-romantic philosopher. Couldn't possibly address all this sort of stuff Kant does. I don't even understand a word of it. But here I'll give you a few thoughts where Kant becomes very influential. One is, just to throw this out as a way to think about art, Kant addresses at a certain point purposeless purposiveness. I just love saying that. A kind of cheap, easy way to put this would be like art would be something that is purposeless yet has a kind of form to it. And I like the example of, it's the difference between a flower and a painting of a flower. So a real life flower has all this color and beauty. So why isn't it an artwork? Well, because that color and beauty has a purpose, all right, which is it's sexual reproduction, it attracts bees, it's pollen, and so on. Whereas a painting has all of that form and structure and color, but it's purposeless, at least in that sense, right? So this is one of the things Kant throws out that I think is, it at least opens up the question for us to think, what's the purpose of art anyway? If it's not to teach and to delight, what is it doing? A little bit more influential, though, in terms of what Kant does is, see, Kant was responding to a whole bunch of philosophy at the time that was like David Hume and other people essentially kind of undercutting the possibility of having knowledge in the world. And so at least in terms of art criticism, the question would be, how can we judge, where do we get our standards for what art would be? And Kant has this way of sort of solving certain sets of problems, perhaps creating others. But he does it partly in terms of art. This is critique of judgment. This is one of his major critiques. By saying that art, standards of judgment for art aren't objective, right? It's not that we can all walk around and say, look, that's beautiful. We all know it's beautiful. We're all going to agree that it's beautiful, at least not on that kind of level where art's just sort of pinned down. It's not objective, but for Kant, it is universal. And that might seem a bit contradictory, because it is. Kant's a damn monster. For Kant, nonetheless, what you've got going on in artistic production is a kind of free play of the imagination and creativity, which connects to these universal truths, things that are sublime. And so in some sense, it is universal, but it also allows for this kind of open possibility. And that argument, I always argue it's the foundations of modern democracy, right? It's actually this question of, well, we can listen to people and what they think about things, and their voice matters. We don't just get divine right of kings, but it's universal, these issues. But then that allows for a kind of universality of art, too, that people have this kind of capacity to produce art because they're in touch with these things. So Kant kind of unshackles things from having to teach and delight in some ways, right? Because now you've got this other kind of sublime space that art's coming from. And that, we're still in the wake of that, as far as I'm concerned, this kind of thing happening. Where does art go from there? Oh, God. In the immediate couple of centuries, at least in Europe, it goes to things like art for art's sake, which is one of those terms that pops up in France and a couple of different places. In England, through Ruskin and Walter Pater, and then Oscar Wilde would be one of the other sort of champions of it. And this is where you really have people saying, look, I'm not going to teach anymore. Oscar Wilde makes his argument of, oh, God, the only flaw with my novel is that it had a moral to it, right? I was accidentally teaching something in getting to this artwork. So you have this whole host of people sort of trying to abandon those things. And think about this. Sometimes it's is that a philosophical response? Is it a mechanical response? I sometimes think that the blurriness of a lot of late 19th century art has an awful lot to do sometimes with the invention of the camera. I mean, people just said, well, I don't need to be exact anymore. The camera is doing that. Art could do this other thing entirely, right? I that purpose can be abandoned for a new one. So art sort of starts working this through this way. Ultimately, this goes in the 20th century. I'm trying to just jump to something that what you would end up calling postmodernism. And dear Lord, I am a postmodernist, so I would just sort of jam this down your throat all day if I could. But one of the fast, easy ways to put it is through Heidegger, who's fairly important in art criticism. With the origin of the work of art is the essay, this is one of my favorite sort of things to talk about. Actually, Heidegger talks about that the framing of an art piece is important. So this is at least one quick way to get at it. And I mean, he gives an example of a peasant woman's shoes. I mean, he has specific art that he addresses. But think of it this way, you see this piece hanging in the museum that is a peasant woman's shoes. That work is framed in such a way that you now think of it, you think of the shoeness of the shoes, I'm using Heideggerian language, right? You think of the connection of the shoes to the earth, the connection of the shoes to labor, the connection of a certain kind of person who produces a certain kind of thing. You wouldn't do that, let's say, if you were walking down the street and you saw a peasant woman walking wearing shoes. So that framing allows a certain kind of truth to come into being, this is the way Heidegger would put it, that you simply wouldn't have known before. But for Heidegger, it's maybe not even a revelation or this sort of coming to see a truth that was there. It's the creating of a space where that truth can finally exist. I mean, for Heidegger, there's this really active element to this. It's not just that art lets us see things, the truth in Plato's sense, right? But it creates that truth, right? That there's this kind of productivity to it. Maybe that's something that comes out of Kant. It sort of depends on how you read Kant. And you could see that this leads me to a certain kind of argument I love to make, which is that critics of postmodernism, I have my little private agendas, right? Critics of postmodernism always end up with this kind of argument that it's nihilism, right? Oh, this is a total indeterminacy of values. Those people are crazy. And I would say to you, no, in fact, it's quite the opposite, right? There's this extraordinary attention to the question of how things are framed and valued, like sort of interest in that. 20th century is dominated by a whole bunch of people who are very, very interested in frames, in forms. Clive Bell, there's all these sort of names. But this is why. This is a sort of movement to a thought about those kinds of things. So only a few little more pieces, and I'll hand it over. One is one of the other big people for this in art, but then in all the stuff I am doing, is a Frankfurt School Marxist named Walter Benjamin, who has an essay, Art in the Age of Reproduction, translated a couple ways. Benjamin points out how art changes significantly when you think about when mechanical reproduction alters the world. So it's considerably different what an artwork is if it can be reproduced on a mass scale. That you'd think, well, why would that be true? Well, it's true in this sense of why go to a concert if you can listen to it on CD. I mean, you know, like 700 years ago, going to a concert, this is the only time you're going to hear that music ever. It takes 50 people to produce it. But now you could ask the question, why would I ever go to a concert, period? Benjamin talks about it in lots of ways. One of the terms he uses is the idea of aura, like that certain works would have attached to them a kind of specific historical specificity to them. So I still go to the concert because that's different, right? It is imbued with a certain kind of force and value for me that's because of these circumstances. This is sort of Marxist idea, right? That the circumstances matter. For the form, the frame matters. But you could say the same thing, I think this very particularly about the Mona Lisa, which is that why would the Mona Lisa be at all valuable? Why would anybody pay millions for this thing? Because if you go see the Mona Lisa, you are going to be standing, if anybody's ever experienced this, it's in the Louvre, right? You're like 30 feet away from it. There's 900 sort of smelly people between you and it. It's behind, like, 6 inches of bulletproof glass. I could go online and see extraordinary detail, but see, that doesn't have any aura to it. So this is Benjamin's sort of thought, like, okay, we need to think these considerations when we're working through this. One of the other things that Benjamin does in one of my sort of favorite pieces from him, The Task of the Translator, which is a language thing, surprise, English literature, in The Task of the Translator, Benjamin says, you know, a good translation doesn't have anything to do with the content. And it's not a question of the audience. Like, I don't write translations so that some audience member can hear it. It doesn't care about that. Like, a good translation might do entirely different things. It would be a question of how these languages play off of one another, where they fail. That might be the sort of, like, that. There's where we could ask questions we could never ask before. Something art could do is to think things that haven't been done or thought. So Benjamin sort of says, this is what your artworks do. They don't have to be shackled to the idea of delighting an audience or making them happy. This is something we are thinking quite a bit about. What could we do that would be horribly monstrous for all of you? Okay. We abandoned that. But this is how I want to conclude, which is just a kind of a personal note. But just personally, in the last few years, the research and the stuff I've been doing and the people I read, like Richard Forty's geologic times, billions of years that we inhabit in this, and there's 7 billion people on the planet. I read Ian Banks, he's a British sci-fi historian guy who just talks about, you know, the massive numbers of people. I don't believe in ethics and truth and hope anymore. I mean, realistically, the world is body management. You know, we've got these people, like, that's how we develop our political systems. Like, how can I move these people around, get rid of their waste, feed them? And that's how we generate our ethics and our thoughts. Higher education, I've just lost my faith in. And I say this to you, like, yeah. So where do you go from that? So I just don't believe in it, but like I don't. But if I'm wrong, okay, and I mean I've been wrong so many times. So if I'm wrong, I don't think I am, but if I'm wrong, if there's hope, where is it? There's only one place. Art. That's where it is. I mean, and I'm actually sort of being romantic. I'm being Percy Shelley. It's not art, it doesn't have to be painting or something, right? Shelley just says, look, legislators can be. You can be a truck driver, and doing a truck driver artistically, right? Like, there are ways to do this. Like, how are you approaching the project that you've decided? What are your projects? That art, right? Art would be that question. If there's a definition of art, it would be the question of, is there something at all worth participating? Again, I don't think so. But if there is, this is it, right? This is it. Like, that's where you define it. And that's, I mean, that's why I love working with Xenia, right? Right, and that's, so on that note, I hand it over.
Wow. Well, thank you, Steve. That was a lovely excursion through the major points for framing and viewing art making and through the ages, whatever. And abandon all hope, all ye. So here I would like to start my little spiel with a board shot of class yesterday. This is this semester's class, Aesthetics and Criticism, where our students, our art makers in the department start thinking about what art is and is not to them, right? So right away, you know, and I know I write badly, but right away you see that they are very sure on this second class day that art done through outside motivation or to fulfill exterior or external expectations, aka homework, is definitely not art. You know, and then you see like a bunch of nice stuff, but definitely homework is not art. For me, in turn, teaching this class, I think, begins a lifelong conversation for them in terms of positioning their own practice within the broader discourse of today. Framing, if you will. Help them frame themselves in their production. I think homework can be art. Right away in this not PowerPoint presentation, I would like to throw out the idea of taxonomy, right? So the taxonomy is a branch of knowledge having to do with classification, right? Perhaps like art theory, who knows, and criticism. So the taxonomist kind of collects naturally observable phenomena, usually plants, animals, what have you, usually not pieces of art, and starts classifying them using kind of categories that he or she has set up for purposes of analysis, right? The categories aren't there to begin with. I would like to propose that art is not a taxonomic category, right? Art does not exist as a result of analysis of it. So who cares who thinks what about art? It's the entire root system, right? That was a drawing I made back in 2008. I might be lying, could have been some other year, I don't remember. Thinking about these issues, right? So something that is, to me, very alive and very like the blood platelets at the top, you know, turning into this tangled mess and then being surgically inserted or attempted to be inserted into a hole that may not contain it. All right, but I'll back up because, you know, one mention of Plato on top of whatever mentions of Plato is not enough for the day, right? So let me beat it to death. So Plato and his near contemporary, I believe they were like separated by two decades, no more, right? Polycletus, a sculptor and obviously the author of the Canon of Proportions, which we still use today. So whereas for Plato, right, the art and artists are at least twice removed from truth or any real ideas or thought. They're just imitating what can be observed, and that which can be actually observed is a shadowy kind of thing, apparition of something that was related to truth or ideas at some point. So while Plato is thinking about art, Polycletus is making the rephorus, the spear thrower, right? And what you're looking about few decades before Plato writes anything down is not a depiction of a particular guy. It's not a portrait. It is a public sculpture meant to commemorate idealized athleticism. Ha. Huh. So Polycletus, before Plato, is not imitating nature, but participating in the world of perhaps truth or ideas or something. I don't believe that there's a truth, but ideas, world of ideas. Where do we go from there? Who knows? Ah, let's see if art has ever been just a mere imitation of anything, right? And this is the writing of Norman Bryson. I'm not making this stuff up. You can go read his book. It's called Looking at the Overlooked. This, right? So still life, a straightforward depiction of little common household objects. What's going on with that, right? So what you're looking at is actually Xenia, plural, spelled exactly like my name, or Xenian, singular, and it is a category of Roman painting, few examples of which survive to today, because it was used to, Xenia was used to decorate people's houses. And houses were, you know, ravaged by time and subject to, you know, natural events like the eruption of the Vesuvius, right? So Xenia usually represent cooked and raw foods, right? So the raw foods are your fruit, your milk, your honey. The cooked foods are usually cheese and wine, right? And though really elaborate in preparation, they're really natural products made, like transformed, transfigured through natural processes, right? So in fact, what these Xenia are doing, they're not representing common objects or things sitting still. What they are is they're part of this ritualistic process of welcoming a Xenos, foreigner, stranger, guest, into your oikos or house. Right? They're an offering, symbolic offering to your guests. Great. Because if I were to offer my guest from somewhere else, some other culture, some food that I've prepared, they might be offended. They might not find it tasty. Their tastes could be very different, right? Whereas by offering them a Xenia, I'm offering them the fact that the nature of the place where I live is welcoming them. So the nature is welcoming them. I'm not, right? You know, and of course, Xenia look very much like other still lifes throughout the ages. Before I get to the Spanish, though, let me go to Philostratus. Right? Right. Okay, I had to look up that. I'm not confusing. Philostratus is a sophist. He is writing and teaching in Athens and Rome in the 3rd century AD, right? And while he is obviously saying that copying, surface resemblances are very important to art, to him what is the most important aspect of art is that it has decorum. What in the world? Decorum he sees as intelligence. So he's calling in the 3rd century AD, he's calling for art to cause a movement of thoughts through the viewer, I like that. That's all we want from you. Think something. We don't care what. So on to this still life that looks like a Xenia. Look at this, though. In composition, yeah, very simple, you know, just, again, natural products, vegetables and fruit. These fruit, however, are not ripe and abundant, right? They're kind of beat up and wilted and somewhat nasty. It's almost like you wouldn't eat them, right? Same with this, Zurbaran and his painting of objects. They're kind of humble objects. They're almost pathetic. They're not gilded. They're not the property of kings or royalty, aristocracy, whatever else, right? So what is happening here, despite surface appearances, that one's a still life, that one's a still life, right? The truth is, it's just still life. However, what is happening is that these artists are followers of, what's his name, Ignatius Loyola. Right? So by lavishing all of this time and all of this attention on the humble, the unassuming object, they're engaging in something that in art terms we will call rapography, from the word ropos or trifle. Right? So they're reminding you, the viewer, to be humble, to lead a monastic existence in all things in your own life, right? Very different than what Xenia are doing. Okay, oh boy, there's more, right? And then there is this. This is also 1600s, and I don't remember if it's Flemish or Dutch. Maybe can someone tell. But this is the Vanitas tradition, right? So still life. Clearly a bit more elaborate than the other ones. But here again, we see that these objects are not just being objects. They're not just there. So what this is doing is that flowers are representing life. There's a sand, dial, sand, watch, whatever that's called, right? Which represent, what's it called?
Hourglass.
Hourglass, thank you. Speak English, Xenia, speak English. The hourglass is meant to represent time. Obviously, the skull stands for death, and the whole thing is a memento mori reminding you all to take care of your eternal soul and not just go after the pleasures in life. So kind of similar to the Spanish, but not really. A little more overt. Fantastic. Ha. And then there's this, right? And I'm gonna say this is a very different medium. This is still a still life. Those are cigarette butts standing very still. This is now a photograph, right? So much more contemporary. I would argue that this is part of that kind of tradition of rapography, of looking at that which might not seem significant. No, it's not beautiful. Nor is it supposed to make you happy necessarily. The point here, right? The point is that you can't kind of see the content of an artwork despite whatever visual similarities you see between that artwork and other artworks as something external to it, something that is, you know, can be categorized from the outside or after the fact. Each artist, rather than producing within a taxonomic kind of category, designs each work to already fit into some kind of genre, movement, or field that the work will contribute to. So innovation in art becomes not about some new thought or new idea or new open possibilities. It becomes much smaller. It becomes like a mere inflection, a mere kind of personal trait, personal sign, that each artist in each new work kind of is able to contribute to a broader field of knowledge that's already out there. Tiny, tiny little gestures. Not big, not grandiose narratives, not heroes, not monsters. Small. Right? A similar thing can be said for Bill Viola's work. And this is two women from Transfiguration, right? So where basically it's a video, right? And there's a sheet of water falling and people are kind of putting their hands in the water, very similar to washing your hands, right? And then they're crossing the sheet of water. And whereas on one side of the sheet of water they're in black and white, on the other side they're in color. Look, it's very different from those still lives we saw, and yet it's dealing with those same themes of life and death, and this idea of a simple motion, like touching water, having something to do with bigger ideas. Again, not about beauty at all, and I'm sorry I was lazy and did not look up what they were called. Kekisme. Right, here we are, we're bodies. We're not perfect, we're not grandiose, we're not gilded. It is our duty to remember who we are as people. So perhaps that is all that art is or can be, is a reminder of who we are in face of everything we could have been and all the narratives we weave. I'm almost done. A few of my own I couldn't resist. Let's talk about Xenia yet again. So this is no free lunch, right? This little sad, tired, horse-like creature with fingers instead of a head, you know, in some kind of urban landscape, perhaps that's a cityscape in the background and some fence, comes upon the, that's a prize-winning cupcake, people. It's labeled as such. It says first place, right? And it's contemplating it, but at the same time, there's some kind of dead bird floating in the sky. It's almost like a thought bubble, or perhaps some kind of poisonous spider coming at it. So that's the thought, that's the only thought there, that, you know, as something good comes to you, perhaps something else might happen, right? At the same time, what is often, what I often hear about my own art is that it is grotesque. Right, let's look at some grotesques. I love grotesque. I work in the tradition of printmaking, right, where we see a lot of these grotesques. So Martin Schonhauer, a brilliant printmaker, and what he's doing there is he's putting together people parts with monster parts. And what is really delightful to me in this work, of course, it's he is very religiously motivated and is trying to admonish us to, you know, not be tempted by things and reminding us what not to be like. Again, art. Morals what? But what he's doing is he's combining human parts with monster parts. And the monster parts are somehow observed, right? Those feathers are very feather-like. The fur is very fur-like. So there's this kind of sense of it's real, but it's not. We're so human. My computer breaks. No, here's some more, Runewald. I could just show you grotesques the whole time. I'm trying to avoid a conversation on beauty and how the ideals of beauty have shifted and how really these ideas that art should be beautiful mean that that same art should not be human, right? Like somehow beauty and those ideals lie outside of our realm of experience. So mine lie very much in my realm of experience, but at the same time are not cathartic. They're not about really me. So this is Tempting Fate. It's etching and lithography. Here's what's going on. There is an alligator, because I live in Southeast Texas, because I didn't look at actual alligators, unlike the previous examples. It has maybe three rows of teeth, just in case, to be more convincing. Above the alligator's mouth, there's a hole. Around the hole, there's some cowboy-like figures with, you know, high-waisted jeans and work boots gathered round, and they're kind of sticking their hands in to the hole above the alligator's mouth. One guy has lost his hands, clearly, the guy on the side. Above them, there's hands that could have be those same hands that are lost, except they've now caught the golden fish. The golden fish is a Russian fairy tale thing. Whenever you catch a golden fish, your wishes will come true. So stick your hands in, either or, right? You know, and there's the golden fish, perhaps, coming out of the hole. Tempting Fate. The only thing that's really true of my life at that moment, and is autobiographical, really about me, is the little inset of the asp and the wasp killing themselves together. They're biting and stinging each other. comments. These things happen, right, in interpersonal relationships. So this is how it really gets put together. It does. Right? So the way it got put together, the whole image didn't start as this autobiographical narrative or as these cowboys. It started because I went to the Goodwill store and I found a diary of a local little girl who has terrible spelling. And you can see I'm copying her handwriting in the print. And she's the most miserable human being in the world. And I was really touched by that. So she's telling you a dreadful story about suspicious teachers, dreadful information, and all of that stuff. Which she should. Her spelling is wonderful, too. At the same time, I took a visiting artist to Gator Country. And the bosses weren't around, and there was this guy wearing quick hands or no hands. And guess what? That actually happened. We actually watched. He, no hands. Just one. It's okay. He lit the cigarette directly after the bite and seemed okay. He was in shock. Then I made some alligator, and then I started kind of telling myself a story. So my stories kind of come together. They go beyond my own experiences. I didn't get my hand bitten. I just looked at it. I observed it. It is, you know, small gestures and slightly more interesting narrative. So I'm hoping my viewers will kind of start connecting to at least some aspect. Right? This was a drawing. Clearly incorporating those same themes of hope and death and life, history. A lot of these images were sketches that I drew in Italy while we were there at the La Specola, the one of the earlier anatomical museums. This is me making it again, story by story. They're all different. Someone gave me a glass of dead bees. I thought that was beautiful. Ta-da! And that's it. So, small themes on what it means to be human. I'm sure I forgot half of the stuff. No, wait, don't go away yet. I was gonna read you, man, okay. Can I read you a quote, just one quote? Okay, this is Tristan Zara, who's a Dada artist, right? This is from one of his earlier manifestos, and it says, "Beauty and truth in art don't exist. What interests me is the intensity of a personality transposed directly and clearly into its work. A man and his vitality, the angle from which he looks at the elements and the way he is able to rescue these ornamental words, feelings, and emotions out of the basket of death." Ta-da.
Well, I want to kind of ask a question that might bring them both back together, and you may choose not to answer this, but you did bring up Benjamin, and for me, he's very influential for me, and I'm wondering if you might address, either of you, the idea of the critique being internal to the object. That you find critique within the object itself. The object dictates the viewing.
Of course it does. Did I not address that?
I just thought you might
expand. Yes. The object dictates the viewing.
The internal structure.
You mean like it's self-conscious? Like it has to have a self-conscious criticism within it?
That you find through form the critique of the object. So if you're finding new form and new information, the new form dictates the critique.
Correct.
Right.
Okay.
It seems obvious.
Yeah.
But
hold on. To that, I would like to not answer that question. I would like to talk about how there's a broader conversation in the community of printmaking and printmakers. The conversation goes like this. Is such a thing possible as contemporary printmaking? when you're, for some reason, you printmakers, engaging with really antiquated processes, really time-consuming, and everything you do is so against instant gratification and non-linearity and all of these other, say, mosaic thought and all of that, that are part of today's discourse. And I don't know, is printmaking, contemporary printmaking, feasible? I don't know.
And I'd move my question to the combination. We're talking about how we experience art from the past, but then when we come present or experience the art, or we go to an opening, we're around the artist and we're hearing criticisms. We're now in the process. And so that's the difference. Somehow process is mixed in this current exposure to art versus something from the past.
That's true. That's
Printing is known to be the fourth technological revolution. Do you see any connection in printing, 3D printing, some of the things, except a few others I saw, couldn't print that, in your and useful teaching model or research or?
Well, strangely enough, the second it goes to 3D printing, we start speaking to our sculptors in the audience and asking them. So,
I'm a sculptor.
Yes.
Not a sculptor.
Sorry. English pronunciation.
I look like a sculptor.
We can debate.
Basic. Yeah. But suddenly, because with printmaking, right, what I didn't say is that it is really the kind of printmaking I do is not reproductive technology. Each impression that I pull is considered original art with its own aura because, well, there's no entering the same river twice, right? I'm not hitting print this way. I'm spending anywhere from an hour to 2 hours to whatever, just making the thing to print. And then I'm spending another whatever, however much time, just wiping ink. And every time I do so, even though they're repeated actions, the fact that I'm human creates a slightly different result.
So, bouncing off of your question, perhaps we could engage notions of authenticity and mechanical reproduction, and how do you locate that?
Right. That's better.
Well, I was going to say, isn't the fact that you've chosen that drudgery as part of your artistic expression really related to the follower of Loyola who just wanted to paint, you know, those spaces as a humbling sort of process, that there's something that inside that you just feel is humbling and grounding about the drudge work?
The answer I was going to have a little bit earlier that's I think still somewhat related is to go back to Heidegger, who talks about poetry and language in this one particular way, which is that one of the reasons you would pay attention to poetry is because it's a language that is not going anywhere, you know, as opposed to any sort of other directed sort of purpose for talking to someone. I'm communicating an idea. Poetry would be something that would allow you to stay right where you are, at which point you could suddenly start asking a totally different set of questions. And I think maybe drudgery allows that same possibility, that you're sort of working through something over and over again, so you're staying there, and that just that allows you to think about the object itself rather than what that object's being used for as a kind of tool or purpose.
I work for the state of Texas by teaching at a college, and so I've applied for grants where I have to ask for money to support art and literature so that it helps with social or literary goals. I've entered into design curriculum, I've written course description. What y'all said, am I destroying art?
Well, you are still participating in creative activity, right?
I write some great memos.
There you go.
I don't know, that's debatable.
Driving a truck can be art.
If you, I mean, I suppose you could say, in that the institution you are helping to produce is a work of art, right? Yeah. Sure. Sure.
That seems to get to me to this issue of representation, of like in a political representation sense of this two kinds of conversation. One is you're an authority figure trying to teach somebody something, and just it's a one-way conversation, somebody from a position of authority to somebody who's subordinate, versus a conversation which is you're just sort of like piquing people's curiosity. You're sort of saying, this is my experience, what's your experience, let's meet in the middle in sort of a dialogue. And it does seem to be that with the grant writing and things like that, they want you to prove that you are teaching something, which is anti-humanities. I mean, in many, it's just not the humanistic enterprise at all. It just goes back to, you know, you might as well just be, I mean, I'm a historian, so you might as well just be carving like statues in ancient Egypt of like Ramses. You know, because it's like, this is what we do. We make statues that look like this so that you will be in awe of a greater idea, instead of, hey, I'm a human and I sometimes feel like a wasp and an asper killing each other. You know, like, there's a difference. I mean, you don't put that in your art because you're trying to say, you're not trying to teach anybody anything. You're trying to say, Come be,
come
commiserate, and be touched.
Look on my works, ye mighty, in despair. That's the line from Ozymandias. I'm sort of thinking that's about this collapsed civilization. But there's the lesson for you: is this is a great work of art. You need to learn its power.
What we have in our educational system is a vast disparity of power, and, you know, it's hard to continue, it's hard to mix those two different modes of communication. I mean, they're just different genres, you know?
But isn't that what university is about? When he was saying it's universality, therefore, and I must say, I teach art, because I teach literature, and I consider literature art. Joel teaches art. He teaches theater, drama, the music. I mean, we all, to a sense, let's not just speak of the art of teaching, which I also consider it an art, but also the fact, and that's where I disagree with, or maybe not, with Steve, but the idea of when you say the answer is art, it includes education also. And there I am more of a classicist. You consider yourself a postmodernist. I consider myself a neo-baroque. And I actually believe your paintings, you refute taxonomy, but you are classifying yourself by the way you show us.
Yep.
Therefore, the reason for no PowerPoint, because by the way you show us your art, you have in the way you said it, you consider yourself the descendant of this tradition of the St. Anthony's grotesque, or the Cotan and Zurbarán, which, by the way, I teach in my classes when I teach literature also, the idea of this artificiality of the art. That's what you are talking about. That's why you can almost touch those Xenias or those fruits. You know, and when you are about to do it, you realize that it's not three-dimensional, it's bi-dimensional, so then that's artificial. It's created by a person, and then it goes beyond that. But the whole universality of that, I think, is extremely important, and I'll be quiet now. Sorry. I teach this, and I love it, and I think you both have done a fantastic job about giving me another angle that I will include in my classes, so thank you very much.
May I say something? You just kind of brought two thoughts to my mind. One, of course, is Tolstoy, when he's writing about art, right? And it's one of the expressive kind of theories of art. But what he says artists and scientists, in parentheses, and then he talks about what the creative act is and what art is, and he says all art starts with a vague notion, a question that is bothering the artist or scientist, in parentheses. And the art itself is this investigation until the artist or the scientist. It ends when the artist or the scientist has found an answer for themselves for that moment. Mm-hmm. That's it. Mm-hmm. So, and the second thought that I had while you were speaking was that whole idea of we learn facts, we learn theories, we read theory, we read literature, precisely to position ourselves within a broader world as human beings. So what I'm teaching is this ability to start positioning yourself, too.
There are demographics, and this, I'm going to speak for a side outside the scholastics. When I go to openings at museums or at galleries, Houston, Dallas, Fort Worth, 6 years ago, I would never see a Lamar student. And so now I go to these openings, I see students from Lamar, we engage in conversation, we have coffee, we drink. Fort Worth Modern went to a recent exhibition. Two students were there from Lamar, recognizing, engaged with them. And I'm going back to, there are demographics. So whatever it is that you're doing and dealing with these opening discussions of philosophy and prospects of art, what is it? The students are engaging in questions and they're having their own dialogue. So if that's where we're at, then that's really good.
Thank you. Thank you, Robin.
I was struck with the incredibly elevating high note that you left your comments, Christine. And I was thinking, Dennis, of the opening that you had with the photographer who had the Civil War scene.
Elliot Dudick. Mm-hmm.
And, you know, so much of the dialogue that had happened in the social sciences informed his work. So it works both ways. You know, the context of discussion can fuel, as actually you were commenting in your work, it fuels your work, and likewise the work fuels the context. So the issue of where truth is may be embedded in context, and that's really where the phenomenologist is coming from today. And you know, so there's that marriage between pure theory and the work that's still done in that space and very critical to the evolution of thinking, and where the phenomenologist now sits right, and the role that they're playing in that conversation. But it really is a conversation. There's a dialogue going on, whether it's between English and art and English, or whether it's the social sciences in a broader mm-hmm. sense, and what's going on in the artistic space. I'm a little more optimistic than you.
One thought that comes to mind is an awareness that I came to when I was on the search committee for the art education professor, that all of those applications had a philosophy of art. And I feel like in music, I don't know if Eric would agree with me or not, all of the philosophies of art were so very socially oriented.
Yeah.
And I don't see that in music, and it may be that I'm too focused on what I'm doing, but I don't see it around. But I thought that was such an interesting point to me. And when I've seen some of the student works in the galleries, there might be a statement or two, not a full philosophy, but a statement or two from the student, just very socially connected. And I what, Eric, do you see that in a social connection of our philosophy of music or music education?
I think that something I noticed in some of the art versus other, and I've always thought this when I go to a museum, Crystal Bridges, Northwest Arkansas.
Okay.
Andy Warhol had an exhibit there. And mm-hmm. some of the stuff I was looking at, I was like, man, I should just go home and make some art. Like,
but that's it. He inspired you.
Yeah.
And then make that art.
And then other stuff is just heavily rooted in technique. Mm-hmm. And, some of the aspects of a piece of work, a broad area, a plane of color, a child could probably make that, you know, spilling a can or a cup or something, and then there'll be a detailed element of a fish or something that you would not expect until a master or a near master. And so I think in music, we are so heavily pursuing technique that it almost, you know, because it just doesn't sound like anything quality until a certain technical level. And so, I think maybe that sort of shapes philosophy of music in some way, because you don't even, it can't be so maybe universal, at least not until it's in certain accepted ways. I mean, anybody can just pick up a bass guitar and just figure out something that they think sounds cool, but I think what we do in institutional music is we even kind of try to distance ourselves from that because of the expense. I mean, music is expensive. Paints are expensive.
Right. And I don't know if you saw on the board, that is one of the very first conversations we have with our students. And that is something we address consciously as a department. That is what we teach. We teach them the technical foundations, right? Because without that technique, without the hand skills, their vocabulary is limited, right? But then we also, as a department, I think, address the development of their thought. And one of the first conversations all the students want to have when we get into theory is, well, that's not art, because here we've been in school for a few years and we've had to learn all these things, and that doesn't have technical mastery, or it doesn't have some kind of genius or giftedness or whatever else. And I think at some point in, I don't know, for my artistic practice and my artistic career, being technically perfect or virtuous or good became kind of equated with, you know, I don't remember who said this, to make an absolute illusion is to make illusion absolute. So to somehow too much technique, too much craft has connotations of not being true for me and my practice. And I think each artist at some point of their careers has to negotiate their own relationship between technical perfection and truth or not truth or whatever
something
they want to say.
Something that makes it compelling.
Exactly.
Authenticity.
Mm-hmm. Earnestness.
What makes it compelling?
Yeah.
And it's that little quirky moment usually, right? Mm-hmm. Where it drops below technique.
One of the ways, one of the things we didn't bring up, or quirkiness or flaw, I mean, Poe talks about Ligeia, like real beauty would have some sort of element to it that's not perfection. You know, the other critical voice that Xenia and I use quite a bit to think some of this is Baudrillard, who talks about simulacrum and the question of whether things are real or what that would mean, to this sort of notion of authenticity. That's kicked around.
Pottery intentionally, even the most beautiful pots, intentionally flaws it somewhat.
And that was another thing. Exactly. There's the idea of wabi-sabi, right? The Buddhist Japanese philosophy that is related to the impermanence of life, where the imperfect object is preferable to the perfectly executed one because it's got that lived history or personality. So very similar.
And may I throw something back to our music colleagues? Just coming back to musical technique, and again, I beg some ignorance when it comes to music. What about dissonance? Is that not where you're playing with technique and defying those kind of structures? Does it work the same way as when an artist purposefully draws like a child?
I don't think so, because dissonance has been defined differently in different periods of time. Earlier times, the dissonances were the thirds, major, minor, thirds, and the consonants, well, the fourths and fifths were still consonances, but the thirds were considered dissonant. But in our common practice period, the 1600 to 1900, the thirds are the consonants. And so it's defined differently. And it's also physically related. The the overtone series has to do with our consonants and dissonance. Mm-hmm. So I think it's a little bit different there.
Mm-hmm. Can music ever escape technique?
I don't think so. Mm-hmm. I think the technique has to be there in order to convey the composer's intentions, and also if it's an improvised or a self-composed piece, the technique has to be there again to convey the expressiveness, your personal expressiveness. But either way, the technique has to be there.
What about punk rock?
What about punk rock? Or folk
punk? Not real punk rock, are you?
Or just a simple.
There's technique there too, but
I had a teacher tell me that you need a technique to brush your teeth. Mm-hmm. To tie your shoes requires a technique. So I agree with Charlotte in approaching the taxonomy of codified great music, master music, but I think maybe you just start at basic here I am technique, like I'm a human. Like, these are my genes, I'm a human being. So I have technique level one. I can jump in, but it's going to be technically one. So in this are some of the earliest human forms of music, call and response, where everyone had technique level one, and you had someone with technique level four, and they would sing the tones and say the words, and you would say it back, and they would be congregations participating, or groups.
So punk is technique one?
Not if you're the drummer.
I just wondering, this is more for Dr. Evans. Would it be better or worse for Lamar if the people and disciplines in this room were in the same college?
That's an interesting question.
Well, that's an interesting question. It was an interesting question to start with, irrespective of my observation. There are a number of initiatives afoot across the country where freshmen are engaged in cross-disciplinary ideation and innovation initiatives, and really irrespective of the field. You could be ideating in English or in history or wherever, or art or business or engineering. And it's the cross-disciplinary infusion of these multiple perspectives that invigorates the final product, irrespective of what the final product is. They may not reach a point of truth. It's just all about working together to arrive at some process where you work together and who knows how that ends up. So that is not only a serious conversation, but it's in play. And we've had serious conversations about starting with a beta site of maybe doing sessions with 30 or 40 students who are involved in groups of four or five, and seeing where that might take us and how we learn from it. And there's a rather substantial body of literature out there of how that is playing out. There's no firm end point on this yet, but I think it's a very good question, and I think it's relevant in university environments, very much so.
Well, with that, I think we ought to close. Very interesting, and I have a small gift for you.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
So thank you all for having me.
Thank you.
Thank you all for coming.